To go to the Rock, woo!
Yes, 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 yes. Solid Rock, I stand. Has to be God, because I am telling you, this stock market keeps me busy. Yes, people like Miss Davis calling and griping, yelling and screaming. She wouldn't yell and scream. But she thinks about it. She thinks about it. Yes, indeed. It's so good to take time for this discussion. You know, how do we take charge politically and make sure that our public policy concerns, our government concerns are addressed in the middle of like everything else going and personalities and all of this going on? You know, we have to take a minute to think what's most important. And I have the research. Research was done this year about what Black folk said was most important to us. They didn't ask me, but I'm gonna take their word for it because it's just me. And you know, we live in this environment that it's about numbers because, you know, I hear all these different things and me, like, I'm not political, only from the perspective of making sure that we maximize any administration. It's my job to make sure that, yep, you, Ms. Howard, Ms. Davis, Ms. Jenny Jones, that we maximize, you know, all of the market conditions and we maximize any administration. Because once someone is voted in, you know, we work with it. We have to, you know, see what their public policy is going to be. So this is the perfect time to start presenting our public policy, like presenting to the candidates for president what is most important for us. Because believe it or not, Black people, we represent about 14%. 14% of the voters come from us. And the majority community is about 50-50. Amazing, right? So if the majority community is 50-50, but they know that we may be voting in a particular direction consistently, then we have, you know, an advantage in the party that really can depend on us. So I want us to look at the numbers. Like I know y'all probably know already, but there is a political party that totally dominates the Black vote, you know, consistently since the 1990s, you know, overwhelmingly Black people have voted with this party's interests. And, you know, it would seem to me that, like, hey, it'd be in the pocket. Whatever we need, you know, we would be able to get. I don't know what we're doing wrong, right? You know, like, every time that particular party would be in office, someone should be, like, listening to us. No, we need one of the candidates now. Like, you know, we have, you know, Ms. Harris, And we have Trump. So we got this Harris Trump going on. No, we need both of them to have an understanding of what's important to us. And I think that that's a big concern because, you know, a lot of the majority community assumes, and I'm when I say majority, I'm referring to in the United States of America right now, the white people dominate the vote. So they kind of assume that if there's a black person, you know, in politics, then they're going to take care of black interests. No, I think the majority community assumes that. I'm not sure if everybody black assumes that. How's it going? But when we're talking about the black vote, do you always vote? You know, you don't have to tell me your business. You know, don't have to tell the world. The world, the entire world is listening. You know, Reverend Bozeman, as a man of the cloth, you have such an influence. You have to be very careful in, you know, how you tell them that you vote because the entire world is going with you.
Exactly.
What you say goes.
All right.
Because you got the connection with the Arise, the guided one. Like the you know, do we assume that, you know, if there's a black candidate, like, you know, going back, just say, like, you know, with Obama presidency, I think, you know, that we kind of assume, oh, we were so excited. Black people were really, really excited. And that we were for sure knew that black unemployment was going to disappear because it was evidence, living proof that this is the time of the black man. He is arisen. He is there. But
you would have thought that.
Yeah. You know, rest in peace. Like Herman Cain said that he was the only black man running for president. It's like, you know, that he was black. So his interests were different because he had been a victim of, you know, racism over and over. You know, I also believe that he was a victim of racism when he settled a lawsuit and the lawsuit came back up when he was running for president. No, it was, you know, we could say that that was racism, some would argue. For Bill Cosby, too, you know, like how did all of a sudden, you know, something that was supposed to never be brought up in public again, all of a sudden it's okay and nobody be sued for bringing up a settlement. So, you know, there are different situations for different folk. There's also some people that are speculating that, you know, this is an opportunity for Ms. Harris because they had planned it all along, kind of like the conspiracy with theory with the ear. Now there's a conspiracy, Mr. Barton, with Biden had planned this all along, and that this was the only way to get the black person in as a presidential candidate. That's right. So the my question, and I really want your all feedback, like when we have a black person in the White House or a black person, you know, running, you know, we're only 14% of the population. Do they have to address, now mind you, 50-50 of the other parts of the population are split between the two parties. Black people dominate in one particular party. So the black vote can decide the presidency. Many believe that Biden won because of the black vote. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, he even said in his speech, in the acceptance, he said, you know, black people or African Americans, I think is how he said it. You had my back. I'm going to be sure to have yours.
Right.
And how they have? How did he have ours?
Well, that's what he spoke at that time.
That's what he said. Yeah.
Yeah.
I thought people, that was when. Was that when he
black
committed
people
to
turned
Kamala?
Him around when Clyburn, when Clyburn during the primary, when Clyburn brought, you know, black people out to vote for Biden.
I heard a story today that was when he said, "Come on, I'm gonna pick a black woman." Is that true? Like right around in that same part?
And it's around that same time.
And that's maybe on that same sentence.
But this was after he officially had become president. He said, "I want to thank you, African Americans. You had my back. Now I'm going to have yours."
You know what? And that's why nobody was shot, correct? Like the lady who just got shot. And he's still president. Like,
what lady got
shot? What has changed?
What lady got shot?
Y'all didn't hear about this lady that the police just shot?
Oh, Massey.
We just had her funeral today.
Yeah. They were having a rally in, it's Springfield, Illinois, next Tuesday.
But she had her funeral today. There's no reason to have a rally. The policeman got fired. I don't know what we're talking about. Like, what else can we do? We can't bring her back. They're going to give her millions of dollars. But we have to change the public policy on how these policemen are trained. That man had, beyond a shadow of a doubt, very much confidence that it was time to shoot her in the face.
She had an empty pot of water. Yeah, I don't think that's the first time he shot someone black either. That may have been the third time. I think something like that. I don't think it's his first time.
But I feel sorry for him. He happens to be white. But I really feel the man has a mental health issue. He really, unfortunately, felt threatened. And many people are, we give people a cop out when we call it racism. You know what I'm saying? But a lot of people have a mental health issue. Racism itself is a mental health issue. We shouldn't say racism and then mental health issue. You know, has a mental health issue.
Maybe I want some of these people drug tested. Let's see how much is real. What do you really have going on in here?
He probably was sedated with something too on the job. I'm sure a lot of officers have to take antidepressants and things like that, but we can't continue to allow this to just go on. We have to change the public policy on policing. It has to be changed. As soon as they realize that woman was having a mental problem. You know, she couldn't remember her name. She couldn't find it. It has to be part of the policy. Bring someone here who does mental health. Bring a mental health professional. Right now, something's wrong. This lady, you know what I mean, is having a crisis mentally. And they're not trained. They just thought they were supposed to take care of everything. He got a mental problem. She was having a mental problem. You know? Mm-hmm. And if people really, like you have handicap stickers, if people go home with psychotic drugs or have been diagnosed with a mental disorder, they should have a sticker that they can put on their house at the front door. Something like that to designate like this, you know what I mean? Handle with care. It doesn't have to be anything obvious, just like a purple heart or something like that. You know what I mean?
I want to know how much fentanyl or is in their system. You know?
Yeah, everything. You need to know everything. And we're not mentioning that because it's a cop-out. We're mentioning that because he's taking something that is legal. And in the training process, if the person is taking something that can cause anxiety or some sort of extra psychosis, I don't know, they shouldn't be carrying their gun during that time when they're on that bed. You know what I'm saying?
They could be taking something legal along with things that are not legal.
Okay. I'm concerned about illegal stuff. Yeah. Well, they've definitely checked him for that. But my thing is about the stuff we can control. There'll always be drug addicts and somebody doing a drug, you know, things like that. We'll catch them. They'll get it. But we need to improve the public policy on how, you know, people are handled. I don't even think two men should go in a house when there's a woman there by herself.
I agree.
She was afraid. They were afraid. They didn't know how to handle it. You know what I'm saying? She could have been naked or so, you know, that's just an awkward situation. As soon as they saw us, a woman here by herself, they should walk out.
No. Yeah, I mean, what threat would she, was
she
really?
We're
going to
guard the door. There's nobody in your house. We're going to stay outside until the mental health people get here, Ms. Jones, you know, and then they're done. Doctor can't come in and do your exam on a woman by himself. A male doctor can't. Not saying a woman would handle it better, but the other night when that judge was arrested and that cop in Atlanta, he picked up that woman and the cop was giving him a hard time. He took her to what? A woman. Can you try to get her to calm down and give me her name and this and that? Now, she gave the women a hard time, but he protected himself so that he had other people to back up that she's on something. Something's wrong. She wouldn't tell anybody her name. But if he had stayed alone, you know, she really pretty much could have made up anything.
Absolutely.
You know? And so they should be trained for the for our protection and for their protection. But I would say that we as a people on the top of our public policy concerns, you know, should be things like that. Especially if you're interested in, you know, supporting someone like Ms. Harris. Well, that's what she did for a living. You know, she knows that. It's a concern. Like, we're coming as a community. You know, we should say, you know, this is a concern for us, because I think, like, I saw someone post on social media, you know what? Don't nobody call 911. We can't do that. That's not a response to it. We really need to have, you know, someone like Ben Crump do something productive other than get a check. We need him to say, this is what we're going to do in response to Trayvon Martin being shot, in response to, you know, all of these victims that we've had since Trayvon and before. It's just a blessing that the guy that shot Miss Massey, the partner of him, his partner, had his body cam on, because the actual shooter did not have his body cam on. You should be fired just for not having your body cam on. You're gone.
This is the third police precinct that this guy was working at. He left one, another, and another. And I don't know. I think it's like two or three black people he's shot, maybe didn't kill, wounded, or whatever. He's done some shit like that, though.
He knows how to handle us. That's the way they see it. He's comfortable with black people. In the system, the way it is, if he is not found guilty, he will go on to another place.
Exactly.
They're so short staffed, and the training is bad. Yes, yes, Ms. Person, we're getting afraid of men in the uniform. And many of them are afraid of black people. Like, we're sitting there and we're just like, that little teeny lady?
That's why I don't believe they're afraid. I don't believe the police officers are afraid. I believe they think they can do whatever they want to do. They're not afraid.
That's like somebody coming to your house, Jenny, and like you're sitting there afraid, and then they shoot you in the face. And he said, I'm going to shoot you in the face. So.
Take it away.
I'm sorry, Mr. Barton. It kind of broke up. I heard you a little bit, though. Mm-hmm.
Take you away with the music for police officers.
Could you all hear that?
No.
Say it again.
He's distorted.
I don't know why it's doing that. Yours has never done that before. Yeah. There you go. Your hum was good. He said, hum. We heard that. What'd you say? You know what? Your microphone is turned down. That's what it is, I think.
The better?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then it did it again. But you were saying, I think it's something, and I'm sorry. I don't know why. Like, it's there, but it's just, like, got you muted. I don't know if it's, like, playing. It might be playing a video.
Is
or
there something over the microphone? Background.
I know. Exactly. I am. But you're right. And then type it, and I will translate. Exactly. The But I want to show y'all. I want to show y'all something. First, I Googled what democracy means. So democracy is often said to mean rule by the people. Any system of government in which people vote their elected representatives in. How would you describe a democracy? It says features of democracy oftentimes include freedom of assembly, meaning should be able to do that rally that you were talking about they want to do for Ms. Massey. Association, personal property, freedom of assembly. It must mean freedom of assembly, freedom of association, freedom of personal property, freedom of religion and speech, citizenship, consent of the governed, voting rights, freedom from unwarranted governmental deprivation of the right to life and liberty, and minority rights. Now we know, you know, democracy. Like they, you know, there's a lot of that said, like, oh, eliminate immunity. Yeah, for police officers. Exactly. So Mr. Barden, Mr. Higher Education said, yeah, did you all know? Well, speaking of higher education, I was like, I'm going to start studying stuff like this. Trivia. That nine presidents of the United States never went to college. Mm. We've only had like 46, right? Mm-hmm. So that's like 30% were not college graduates. Mm-hmm. See? They needed Mr. Borden. But I think that is like something that we assume, you know, that everybody went, you know, everybody went and it didn't. And I think they had one guy, I think Woodrow Wilson, is the only one that got like a PhD. And then the other ones were like lawyers. And I didn't know that law degree is a master's. I didn't know that. Like Obama has a master's and, I guess, but everybody that has a law degree, it's like a master's in law. So we had a lot of presidents with that. But you're trivial because everybody's like, I didn't know a president could be a felon. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, wow, like we should really check out all of this trivia. What do I always say though? Don't make up rules. So many of us like make up rules like of what you can't do, you know, just because of what you've told yourself that you weren't allowed to do. When you're allowed, you know, there's a lot of things that we could do. Lone Wolf said, it's not feasible to have a mental health professional respond with police officers on assignments. No. I was saying that they should call them. And then he was saying, we don't have enough mental health professionals available. Exactly. I'm sure. They could just train. You could take volunteers. We should just open up like volunteer mental health people, you know what I mean, that are just waiting on weekends. It's really sad to say how many people have been arrested or killed because of a mental health crisis. I don't want to see the numbers. And I mean on both sides, like the cop having a mental health crisis and, you know, and then other times, you know, the person that called is having a mental health crisis. So we know it. So I've heard, y'all hear about that? Like people saying like, you know, things that are a threat to the democracy. So I was like, let me find out like what democracy is. So I will know when I can tell someone you're a threat to my democracy. And then I want us to look at you know, the vote. I want us to look at the research on what the Black voter is doing and thinking this year. And Pew Research did a study on it. So I was very surprised because I've never looked at us this way, you know, as a people. But this is the stuff that, like, you know, Ms. Harris and Mr. Trump are going to be looking at. So the let's look at this. I'm going to share it. We're going to, I'm going to come here and I'm going to bring it and it's going to move me over. So, like, look at this. Like, I wanted to look at, I had it on PDF, but this is the actual, I should have pulled up the PDF. I wanted to go down. Well, this is good. Can you see here where it says most Black? Now, this was done April of this year. So you'll see Biden a lot, but wherever you see Biden, just think of, you know, Ms. Harris. So most Black voters are aligned with the Democratic Party. Percentage of Black voters who are Dem and the percentage of that lean Republican. So it's like 12% of Black voters lean Republican. Did they do red? Like, is Republican considered red?
Yeah, it is.
And then Democrats say blue, say vote blue.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Democrat is blue, Republican is red.
I just thought I saw that rally that Trump was doing and it was saying vote blue. I guess it would say vote red. I don't know. But I hope that they would be consistent on here because they really going to confuse me. So the percentage of Black voters who would vote for, and it's a, we'll replace this with Harris, if the 2024 were held on that day in April. So
I don't see what you're talking about.
You can't see it?
I see improvements to education and economy, Black American policy, page 13.
I'm looking at one thing and sharing, and it showed you another thing.
Okay.
So I'm going to go back to, see, that was the PDF that I wanted to look at. But I don't want to, I'm going to go back to the PDF, but I'm going to show you the right thing. So when I turn that up, make sure you can see it again. Here it comes. Thank you so much for saying that. Because I was like, I wanted to show you the PDF. So I was showing
the PDF. That's page 13 again?
Yes. And I'm going to go back up to what we, I want to.
Oh, okay. Do. Oh, there we go.
And the, that actual article allows you to get this PDF.
All right.
And then, no, that goes into women. So we, you know, there's a lot of data on us. Most Black voters are aligned with the Democratic Party. And then, so 83% of us said they were going to, you know, go with the Democrats. And 77% said they would vote for Biden. That's interesting. Mm-hmm. 83, but only 70. Well, where's the rest of it? They just didn't want to make.
And then, well, they went over to the
So that means 6%
of them went over to the Republicans.
That's what I was about to say. Yeah, that means that some Black voters were saying in April that they were going to vote for Trump. So the
well, a lot of those are men.
We're gonna see because it does have sex information next. Okay, yeah,
that was a Black male movement.
You think so?
Yeah,
you're from going
from what I'm hearing.
It's that, but Black voters remain largely aligned with the Democratic Party. You know, 77% of Black registered voters say they would prefer to vote for Biden. Let me get down to the sex information. And it says, yeah, see, this is saying, look at the difference between Black men, 20% are with Trump and 16% of women, Black women, are saying at that point they would vote for Trump. Yeah. But the demographic, what am I saying? Democratic ticket dominates for sure. Demographic, I love it. It is demographics though.
Yeah.
And look at the younger people. So they're saying that more younger people, younger Black people are leaning Republican, but the majority of Black people over 50 are, you know, they dominate the preference for the Democratic Party.
Right, so it's traditionalists against the young people. The young people are pissed off at the Democratic Party.
Say it ain't so. And look at this. So this is all voters. This is, you know, white and Black all together. We get all mixed in. 48% Democrat. I would never have thought that. And they're saying 49% of all voters are saying that they're Republican. But look, so did the shooter. So we don't know what people are doing. I mean, I don't know if y'all knew that, but the shooter of that attempted the assassination of Trump was registered as a Republican.
But you know, the young people, be careful that 2025 will affect them more so than it will me.
What?
You know what I'm saying?
I don't know. Oh, you mean that? Oh, you're talking about that thing? Shoot, Trump and Harris, they not thinking about that. We thinking about that more than those candidates. Trump won't even identify with it. But they keep trying to give it to him. But he's like, nah. He's not like, you know, do you really think Trump's going to let somebody tell him what to do?
Never.
Like, exactly. That should be his only response to people that say, you know, we know you're going to do what the Heritage Foundation said. He'd be like, what are you talking about? I have a complete staff of people that we've been working on it over the last 4 years and we're ready to go. They were having meetings like every day over the last 4 years, like, because you know we're going to go back. I mean, I wouldn't put it, never, I don't know. Wouldn't it be something y'all watch on TV says that next week? We're ready to go. We don't need any advice from anybody else. That's all they said in that Heritage Foundation. It's like these suggestions. The fact that Democrats get so mad about it is because they are saying they like Trump. Like they feel that he's more in alignment with what they want, you know, his policy. So,
yeah, they want recognition.
Yeah, and they think, you know, but he doesn't. He won't recognize them. You know, it might happen like near the end, you know, maybe, but there's really no benefit. They love him already. He doesn't have to, you know, it's kind of like how Democrats treat us. It's like, Black people love us. We just, you know, put Beyonce on stage, play some good music, they good. That's how he feels about the Heritage Foundation. Like, why are you spending time with that? That's a given. But, you know, it's sad, but true. It's really sad. Like, I think that, you know, black people are really, you know, our thoughts, our desires, our, you know, concerns, you know, are ignored once we're there. I mean, I've been in meetings and, you know, they basically just get mad that I ask about helping black people with businesses. And those are the type of things that Black men get upset about because Democrats have really reduced the number of Black men with businesses being able to get government contracts.
Right.
No, so it's like, you know, it becomes really hard. Like if you'll probably find, now I don't know, let's look at these people more, but already saw it was younger. So a younger Black person is more likely to be an entrepreneur as well. Older Black people are more likely to work for the government. So that whole Heritage Foundation 2025 reducing the size of the government, you know, would terrify that person because that's what, you know, Black people are more likely to have to depend on a pension for their retirement, you know, and things like that. So we see that we, most Black people have cannot imagine my life of being a long-term entrepreneur. Trump has lived it. Like, you know, so he relates, so more business owners are going to relate to him because they identify, you know, with, he's like, I could do this. We could do it on your own. You could do it on your own. But we have been socialized so much that we, if, you know, if we don't get something from the government, we're not going to be able to make it. But this generation that's coming now is asking for the party to give them more. Just like Fannie Lou Hamer. She was like, you got to give me more. You got to let me in. And I feel that the Blacks who are in the Democratic Party that have that influence could really help the Black community get what it needs if they would increase their confidence and know that, it, as you saw with the Black people, Black women and Black men for Ms. Harris, you know, raised millions of dollars. Millions of dollars. Like, we are so loyal. Like, that should be appreciated. Well, what do you need? Well, we need, since you know that y'all have socialized us to depend on these jobs, we need the Black man to stop being the most unemployed person in the United States. You know, we need to have a livable wage since you want us to not be entrepreneurs because you're not focusing on giving out any business loans and helping entrepreneurship. You want to keep a big government? Well, let us in. Let us in. And if I don't work for the government, can you make sure that we get a livable wage so the person isn't on poverty level? We got people on 40 hours a week on poverty level that cannot afford to live. Working 40 hours because Biden promised to provide a livable wage. And then he said, well, we'll get back to that. We'll just help people with school loans and help them get rid of those.
That's crazy.
It's in the numbers. Like, if you look at who the people with degrees vote for, like, no, like, look, would they ask Black people in this survey, who do you think is mentally fit? Look, it says, has the mental fitness to do the job. In April, 34% of us surveyed said Biden, and only 13% said Trump. And look what happened.
Mm. Wow.
You know that's just personal right there. So acts ethically in office, 50% Biden, 7% Trump. Respects the country's democratic. No, we know what the democracy is. So 56% said Biden, 8% said Trump. No, look at how loyal Biden must have thought the Black community was to him. And look at how quickly we said, I don't care. Get out of the way. Let's start raising money for her. That would be heartbreaking if I was him. I spent 50 years, and this how y'all treat me?
But his record ain't that clean.
No. But we voted for him like that. You know what I'm saying? I'm just saying, like, how we just play each other. Like, you would see these numbers of how committed we were. And then it's like, he said, well, you know, Nancy Pelosi don't want me. George Clooney don't want me. You know, oh my, you know, these are very important people. Like, they're in Hollywood. I guess I'll go. And we didn't say, like, don't go. Don't go. We love you. We just left. We just said, get out. You old.
No, he went out. Fighting still, but Nancy had to really talk to him. It wasn't easy for her to get him to say, okay, it's time to go.
That's terrible. Nothing changed. How, I mean, that shows you, that's why people don't like politics. Like, how can you, especially us as a people, it's like, start, like, don't care about that man overnight. With the amount of loyalty that this suggests, you would think, I'm just saying, like, you know, but doesn't it, like, show you how people just don't respect older people?
And that's why I don't tell my age.
But there's something, I mean, everybody knows you're grown. So if you start like answering questions slowly, that means that you don't have an answer? Or is it just like you're older and you're more thoughtful? And when you were younger, you just spit out answers. I just think it's kind of stupid, the whole debate concept, where you don't even give a person a freaking second to, you know what I mean? And think about it, it's ignorant. So yeah, if we were doing that, I could do it. I could just tell, you know what I'm saying? This and this and that. But is that my best answer I'm giving you? Just because we're showing off? On both sides, no matter what age they are, you know, the whole concept is stupid. We should sit down and do a conversation with them. You know what I'm saying? And let them take whatever time they want to answer that question. Answer the question. Thank you.
What's the purpose of a debate? I mean...
But if you believe in the person's policies the way we said we did, it won't, you know what I'm saying? That won't right.
Well, tell me,
what's the... believe in his policies.
Right? But then, you know what I'm saying? You weren't in that anyway. They ain't calling me. I'm not in this survey.
Well, can someone answer that question? What is the purpose of the debate?
Of the debate, yeah, to humiliate each other. And then Biden was like, I'm going to get out because everybody's picking on me. And I just kind of feel like if you have a good team, no matter how old you are or no matter what you're going through, people should expect, you know, if, I mean, I don't know. I'm not in the party. I'm not in a party. But it's just disappointing. You know what I mean? I don't know. I'm sure they have a rationale for it. But, I mean, he really was pushed out. I just think it's just, you know, they could have saved that for the convention or something. I don't know. It just could have been handled better. But that's my opinion. I don't see what y'all said. People, I'm sorry. Y'all got comments over here and I haven't been looking. Yeah. Dr. Edlow said patriarchy plays a big role. And you using big words. The oligarchs want former presidents. I don't know. That's you just way up there, Dr. Edlow. I'm going to have to Google that. Don't be fooled by Trump saying he's not down with Project 2025. We don't have no choice. He say he not down with it, and they accept that. I mean, it's pretty embarrassing on their part. He say he ain't down with it. That should be the point to make him say he down with it. That, but he has always been a crook. I cared. I didn't want Biden. He said, "What's good?"
Yeah, he was gonna have to go through some heavy duty stuff.
To endure the nasty attacks we would have to endure.
Yeah.
It was going to be brutal. But it doesn't matter what attacks you take away from home. He was being attacked at home. That was domestic violence. That was hard. That's what broke his heart. I mean, he may die within a couple of months or something, and I hope the entire Democratic Party feels responsible for it. But I'm not going to say what Ms. Massey said that he might say to y'all. Wouldn't it be something he comes out, he goes, he gives it. I'm telling you, I am literally afraid because y'all know I used to joke and say, like, I'd say I rebuke you. Remember, I would say that, like, you know, I am afraid of saying that now. Because that cop shot her. You didn't hear about what she said?
No, what did she say?
I'm not saying it because I'm afraid to say it. Jenny, you going to say it?
No, you say it.
No, see, I'm telling you, that cop got us all afraid. Mr. Barden, are you going to say it? It's like saying Candyman. It's like saying, have you ever seen that movie? Have y'all seen that movie? Candyman. So.
Okay.
What did she say, like, though?
It was real religious. She said to the cop, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. And he said, what did you say? And she said, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. And he said, no, you won't. And he cussed her, and I'll shoot you in your effing face. And, you know. And then he did. Just her saying that.
Something that she had the right to say.
She had the right to say anything.
Yeah.
I was just thinking, was she thinking about the white Jesus? And he was thinking about the white Jesus? Would you be something if they were both thinking about the same guy at the same time? Because my Jesus got nappy head. Like, you know what I'm saying? But that guy wasn't seeing the man like, you know, bronze skin and hair like lamb's wool and stuff like, you know, that they, I don't know what he was seeing.
He probably didn't know anything about Jesus.
You don't think so?
That's why he said, I'll shoot you. He wasn't thinking about Jesus.
But what if he's very religious and he didn't like her saying that to him?
If that had been the case, I don't think he would have killed her. Now, I'm religious you, people.
That yeah, could have been more the reason.
I don't know.
He could have said, do you know what she said to me? Wouldn't that be something? I'm telling you, like, what if he says, do you understand what that means? Do you understand that was a threat? That was a threat. I mean.
You know, if he takes it to that degree, I really am concerned about the dope that he's on. I'm serious.
No, that would be his lawyer, his defense attorney. If I was defending him and that man had proof that he went to church, because that is power. There is power in Jesus. I'm telling you. Now, this man literally had a relationship with God. He could probably use that as a defense. That she was like, she was really wishing death on him.
You know what? I do believe he knew what that meant.
I'm telling you.
He knew what it meant.
I'm telling you, that was something else.
He knew what it meant.
You talking about cultural awareness. That would be something. That would be something, you know? Or either, like, you know, her father said that she was prophetic. It would still go in alignment with what she was saying. He said that she felt like she saw something evil coming. That's what I was saying. Like, if Biden does that, like, you know, he could be being cool. Like, my dad would be like that. My dad would be cool as heck, but he was mad inside.
You know what? That's beautiful. That's beautiful. When you,
well, you can do that? I don't know, Jenny. Because when they bust, because when they bless, they bust. Everybody got a limit. And he would just be like, and I would know. I said, oh my God, he's mad. He is mad. Yeah. I know, but no, I believe that there's a whole bunch of black men that walk around looking happy, but are really mad. Black women too.
Now it's called black rage.
Yeah, isn't that sad? It was the other day, yesterday, I got a delivery with Instacart. And I was working and it started raining and that was my groceries to cook for dinner. And the lady, it was a white female that was delivery person. She looked like about the same age as me. And she said, you know, can I just leave them at your garage? Because I don't want to get out of the, I don't want to get out of the car and go to the front door. It would be closer to go to the garage. I said, why are you back there? You should be at the front door. Well, how do I get there? You drive around to the front door. Why are you at the garage? So So she says, wow. And it's raining, it's pouring. There's no cover on the garage. The garage is just a garage door. Like, you're going to leave my groceries. I said, no. So then she said, as punishment to me, well, then I'll just wait till the rain stops. I said, okay, that's fine. But I paid for a rush delivery. So I'm going to have to call and tell them. I was cool as heck. I said, I'm just going to have to call and tell them that to give me my rush delivery money back. Because your time is out. She says, oh, she says, no, I'm bringing it now. I'm bringing it now. I'm bringing it out. She had left that food, my groceries, to cook outside the garage, picked them up, drove around, and dumped those bags at that front door.
Wow.
Went back to her car and took a picture from a distance so that she could say that she delivered, but they could not see the quality of it. They're going to give me my money back. I started then. I said, this is supposed to be, because they tell you how much time you saved by getting. I said, this is supposed to be a saving time. But your delivery person just dropped off the craziest stuff I've ever seen. Like, and that's been two times. Like, why are, you know, that I've had white females do that to me. And I don't understand. Why are you doing this?
Because they don't want
to
deliver.
Exactly. You don't want to deliver. You don't want to deliver at what you think is a nice neighborhood. She don't know it's no black person behind that door. She is being mad because she thinks it's a white female in that house that won't go and get her stuff. You know, because it's majority white neighborhood. So she's not even mad at me. She don't know who I am. She's just mad, you know what I'm saying, that she has to do that. And you think that person thinks they're better than you. So she texts back to me, I guess you're just having a bad day. I will tell Instacart how you acted.
That's what she said to you?
Yes! Oh. I did screenshots on everything and I sent it to them and I said, all I said to her was that I'm going to ask for my, I'm just being honest. I'm going to ask for my money back. She mad at me. Because I'm going to tell them, you know, that you didn't deliver in the time that you said. Like, I think that was a nice offer. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, I didn't want to, like, do it without telling her that, you know, so your time is running. She has to know her time is running out. Like, you know, so you can sit there, but it's a nice summer rain. I would not lose, you know. I don't know. Well, I don't understand what's wrong. You must be having a bad day. I said to Instacart, to the service people, I said, I hope that all your people don't decide not to deliver in the rain. Sound like it was a tsunami or something.
Now, do you put a gratuity in there later?
Yes. And add gratuity.
There's a fee.
A fee.
There's a delivery
and
fee.
And the gratuity. And, yeah.
So the gratuity is already added in?
And I'm a member.
No, the delivery fee and the gratuity are separate.
Yes.
Okay.
And
but I mean,
you can add extra gratuity if they do it right, which I always do. And she's like, well, I'm going to tell them. People are angry in angry in every color. All I ask is that God continue to give me grace so that I'm not angry. I was listening to the tape of Sheila Jackson Lee that just passed.
Yeah.
Did you ever listen to her tape of why she didn't become mayor? When she was in Congress, she cussed out her entire office and they recorded it. She was cut. She called them everything but Jesus. She even brought God in it. I mean, she was going on it. It was so, Jenny. I said, this woman is sitting there sick. She was, you know what I mean? You are sitting there, you know, killing yourself. She just died of pancreatic cancer. But I thought, why in the world? She called one of her employees his fat ass and all this. It was really bad. It's really bad. That's us. We can't go out like that. We can't come in like that. We cannot do this. And then like we make up excuses to be mad at each other, you know, like, oh, well, I don't like it. I don't like Reverend Bozeman because he said he's with the black man agenda with the Republic. You know what I'm saying? he believes in heritage of the 2025. Like, you know what I'm saying? Whatever. What, God is bigger than that. What's the fun in life if we are different? Amen. But I thought was interesting. Like, all of a sudden, like, we're saying, yeah, he is so mentally fit. And then it's like, lo, here, good. I'm glad you're gone. You know, that's so sad. Go. But just the truth, that's just evidence that don't ever feel that the world is going to appreciate you. You know what I'm saying? That the world, yeah,
well, I thought they were bordering on elder abuse by what they were. By what they were putting him through in the first place, because he was, from what I had seen, which was not necessarily on mainstream media, but he was in over his head and his abilities. He was under stress all the time.
Isn't that sad? That's what I thought about. I said, well, Lord, if it was hard on Obama and he was in his 50s, because remember how different Obama looked from the beginning to the end?
Isn't that amazing? That's what I was having a conversation.
That man looked like a model, like a black model at the beginning, and then after that,
listen, Clinton, the same thing. Clinton, the same thing.
Yeah, that's a devastating office.
White,
and he has heart problems. Clinton,
you know, I often wonder, why do you want a job like that? Why do you?
Yeah,
it's like, you know.
Yeah.
You know, every breathe, you never get to rest.
Yeah.
Every breathing moment of those years, you're working. And I'm sure if you dream, you probably dream about the job.
Mm-hmm.
And I would bet you too, go to the medicine chest. It's no telling what you would find in there.
Yeah. I mean, there was a minister was talking about this morning, and it was one of them shorts, but it was talking about that you're not really made to, if you are a nice person, you're not really made to get down into the dirt like that with the other person. You know what I'm saying? Like,
so you're
trying to fight the other person, but you ain't made for that. So what you're supposed to literally remove yourself from it. You know what I'm saying? But we're going more into it. Thinking we're gonna prove our point, we gotta be right, we're gonna do this, and you know, and it's like killing you. And the other person is prospering over, they're loving your breakdown. You know, it's different. Like I was saying about Trump, like he's been an entrepreneur. There are certain things that I can do that a regular person that's had a job, they cannot do. Like Wida was saying, you know what I'm saying? They sit there and they dream about it. Girl, if I sat there and worried about my stuff, I'd never sleep. You know what I'm saying? I had to learn, you know what I'm saying? Around year 10, you gonna have to learn to turn this over to God. People that work for people, they don't know nothing about turning it over to God. Y'all lose a job, y'all up there, oh my God, you don't even remember what faith is anymore. It's like, you're scared. I'm just like, wait a minute, you're gonna be fine. There's a whole bunch, there's millions of jobs out there. Oh, whatever. There's no way ever gonna hire me. You know what I'm saying? But Trump is made for the battle.
Yes, he is.
He's made for the battle. Like certain people, like, you know. And I literally have thought about that. Oh, Kamala, like, you know, there is very few, like, but my entire career, because I'm in financial services, I've been surrounded by Trumps. My entire career. I'm the interface between my black customer and all the money in the world. That's what I do. And it was somebody, you know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, and what was I supposed to say? Oh, no, 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 no. I'm not going to face up to them and tell them that I have something I want to do and I'm going to help the black community and this is going to happen. You know what I'm saying? But that is exactly what God had to show me how to do.
I get it.
You know what I'm saying? And I could not fold on us to do for us. And I had to convince them that we did, we matter, and that what we would bring would help them. I'm constantly interfacing for us. And that's why you have so many politicians that won't do that. Because once they get in there, they turn their back on us because they haven't been working with us all the time. They don't know how good we are. They just take it for granted how loyal we are. We gotta make sure that we start telling people, no matter how black, no matter how white, that we matter and our needs matter. And our retirement matters, and our kids matter, and every generation of black people matters, and these are the things that we want. So when they came out with this 2025 and they decided that they wanted to try to terrify black people with it, the first thing they started going with was the Department of Education, because what? They've seen this survey, and they know that 79% of the black people who responded to the survey that were majority Democrats. So it is Democrats, unfortunately, that are trying to terrify black people about, because they know that we care about education. So we think that our children's education is connected to the Department of Education existing, as if our kids are getting a good education locally. Locally.
No way.
Exactly. That's where we should be directing our energy. You know, we want it, but don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I thought to myself, like, you know, Ms. Massey, when she said that, she said it with such conviction. You know, I rebuke you. And she said it, but yet she bowed. That's what we do. We're saying what we say, but yet we bow. And we got to stop. You want improvements in education, and stand up and stand up for it. And the only way you go down is because they got to kill you. They got to beat you like they beat Fannie Lou Hamer. That sister is the only reason we have a Kamala Harris, is because Fannie Lou Hamer went and took the beat down physically for her. Beat her almost to death so that we could have a person of color, just like Obama, they got to thank her. This woman sacrificed her life to be included in the Democratic Party. They did not want anybody black. Took her off the bus. And that's what we need to tell, you know what I mean, Ms. Harris. Ms. Harris, do you realize we need to be, you know what I'm saying? If it weren't for that woman, you wouldn't have this woman's, you wouldn't have this chance. Mm. Are you talking about reproductive rights? The state of Mississippi cut her uterus out. Fannie Lou Hamer, when she went into the hospital for something else, they said, you're poor, you're black, and we're cutting out uteruses. And we haven't compensated those families. Do you know how many hundreds of black women, you're talking about reproductive rights. That's taking away my reproductive rights. Don't nobody talk about that. Ripped her uterus out because she was poor and black. And we're bragging about how rich black people are so they can give all this money to a party for what? We got to ask for something. You don't just give money. I know this guy walked up to me. He said, you know, my wife has to raise $16,000 to go to lunch with Michelle Obama. We were wondering, could you do $1,600? I said, my $1,600 is going to my payroll. My payroll. You asked me for $1,600 like it's nothing, bro. She want to go eat lunch? I got people who need me to eat? He got me 16,000? What in the world? Are y'all crazy? Are you crazy? You gotta sit there and perpetrate off my money. Off my money. I'm at the gym. Grabbing a few minutes. Just trying to, you know what I'm saying? I'll take it. You will ask me. That's why I guess they don't ask me no more. Are y'all crazy? Ask me to do something stupid like that. That is outrageous. I sit outside, watch her from the window with no hesitation. Oh my goodness. You talk, I mean, we the black women, we are more likely than any other demographic to grow old and be poor. If I could do a tally on who gave this money away to get to that million and a half to a group that does not need the money. They're just doing that to patronize you. And if you have not maximized your retirement account to get at least your employer match, at least the employer match, or you ain't even thought about getting an Afroeconomic so that I can help you not be poor when you get older.
Right.
Because I'm going to tell y'all, with the grace of God, when I shut this down, I'm shutting this shit down. Y'all going to see me riding around town, chilling. I'm going to help everybody that I can now. But y'all keep throwing away money. You keep throwing away money and see what happens. And I'm not giving nobody a dime. And I'm leaving it in my will. My daughter, don't you get them one dime. You better feed the man on the street before you send some $30. They said the average person giving $30. Black folk give hundreds. They don't even know. White people just spend, there's so many of them. They're just sending like $20. We trying to show up. He asked me for $1,600. The last time I just wanted to talk to a Virginia senator, he charged me $200. And they said today. They said today that the average amount that is given is $30. Black folk asking me for $200 just to have a conversation, talk about what I want to do for the community, and then I let you $1,600. What is wrong? So improving education is very important to us. Strengthening the economy came up next. Making Social Security financially sound. These are the things we need to be talking. Right. That's what they need to be telling us. I don't care. You come at it, like all of us, and I'm talking to all of them that are in this majority. You know, you're giving your vote to the Democratic Party, and they spend half of the presentation on how bad Trump is. That ain't going to work for us. We shouldn't let that work. Like, no, you got to do better. You need to tell me where we're going with this. What's our policy? What about these taxes? They're about to be adjusted higher. You know, since you said like, you, oh, goodness gracious. We need to be, that's the 2025.
Yes.
That all of the tax brackets could go higher. We ain't talking about that. We ain't talking about that. They expire next week, next year. Those are the things. This lady told me that her daughter went to the hospital. It was a $2,400 bill. Now, this is in healthcare.gov. Obamacare. $2,400 for this 20-something-year-old to go in to get a procedure made because of a cyst, to get her cyst out. And then her bill was $2,400. Her bill was $1,200 for that 50%. Reducing healthcare costs is a big concern for us. Dealing with problems of poor people. All of these are in 70%. We are such good people. We can do that. We can do that. If your party is not doing it, we need to consider doing it on our own. If these are concerns for us, you know, Afroeconomics talks about all of this all the time. All of it. We need to address, you know, getting our voice together, you know, and what we want to. I am going to send a letter to both candidates on what Afroeconomics, what our top concerns are. And I am going to do a poll before our meeting on Friday of what our top concerns are based on these things right here that the national poll said. And I'm going to see where we fall. And I'm going to add in, you know, things that are just important for, you know, our community. But these things are important for our community. Unfortunately, more of us is on minimum wage than anyone else. So if Biden wanted to do something to help Black people, unfortunately, doing the livable wage would have helped us a whole lot.
Amen.
All of us are good. Thank God. But if you ever have been an entrepreneur like me and Reverend Bozeman, you know that you are only a breath away. We're always living by faith when you're an entrepreneur. Like, all of us really should see that, but somehow we kind of get into the system, and until it kind of hits you in the face, do you realize that, whoa, I got to secure myself. I got to save on my own. Everything, even municipalities now, are reducing their pension. They want people to do it on their own. Mm-hmm. People are so shocked. No, so-and-so don't have no pension. You shouldn't even want a pension, because all that is them keeping your money and you not controlling your return. Jim, imagine if you took control of it, join Afroeconomics, got the me to help you set up the allocation like we do for the members. It is way more. You are in the position of having way more than you would have got off a pension check with something that would have had to been managed conservatively. And maybe you want more growth than that. Well, that's the advantage of having it to yourself. Like when they said, they started talking about privatizing Social Security, you know? And then people were like, people gonna run out of money. People ain't gonna know how to, isn't that sad? That is just sad that we can't believe in ourselves enough to think, you know, that maybe if we did that, you know, J.B. Bryan can actually help us manage my Social Security on my own. Their bucket might be empty, but mine won't be. You would have millions of dollars if that same money was controlled by you. And then, like a client said, her husband passed. Before he could collect his first Social Security check, she makes just as much as him. She said it's just sad to see his money just gone.
Right?
If they had privatized Social Security, she would have a bucket of money for her husband's money. Now it's like, whatever. That's sad. You think about that. A whole bunch of people that happens to. Mm-hmm. Single person, you die, you can't even pass it on.
It's crazy.
Yeah, but we sit there and fight for it not to be privatized. We have to really think about what public policies can we use, you know what I mean, to help us build the wealth and reduce that wealth gap. We need access. We need access to money in order to grow our wealth. We need access. That's the only reason we don't have as much money, because we were more likely to be born with nothing. But they keep telling you, oh, there's a wealth gap. Oh, there's a wage gap. Oh, there's, you know, and for a long time in these United States of America, we couldn't even have investment accounts.
That's right.
No, we have to really think about our history and how important it is for us to set up some different habits and stop thinking that the government is going to be our come up, you know? We are the come up for the government. That's what you're seeing now, that your vote, our vote is needed. We are actually going to decide the next president, and we did the last president, and we decided the president before that. Reducing crime, addressing issues around race is 65%, so that's a concern. Preventing weapons of mass destruction, 73%. Reducing the spread of infectious diseases, 70%. People were concerned, black people concerned about that. We have like, we're so blessed. We're just so blessed. You know, I think, were those numbers helpful just to see it? I mean, most of it we know, but, you know, it's I just think that it's, you know, vital for us to just to develop a better understanding. And I think that we really need to develop a policy and have, a voice. And I really think that is, I keep feeling that way. And that just means that I just need to do it. You know, I just need to do it. That, you know, these are the Afroeconomics, you know, public policy, you know, requests. You know, and that we're excited about whoever, you know, the future and who it belongs to. That way, you know, Ms. Harris won't have to feel like she has to do it. You know, like, you know, some people have said that she feels like she, you know what I mean? She doesn't want to be cornered like that. You know, well, we need to, you know, make sure that she's not cornered like that. Like, but these are just the interests of, you know, our community and some of the things that you know, if you could share your policy and your plan with these things that are important to, you know, our communities, and it will benefit the entire planet. As I put in the front of Afroeconomics book, you know, a stronger black community, a financially stronger black community helps the entire planet. Afroeconomics is about us making greater contributions globally. And some things have to change in order for us to do that. Y'all feel me? Like, you know, we have to have, you know, more confidence about our opportunities other than a jobs. Because if they're going to continue to have where, you know, black men and women have such high unemployment rates, then we need to build our confidence up and realize that we can start our own businesses. And that's a big part of Afroeconomics. And I think that I'm going to, you know, put that in our presentation to both parties as well, that we need, you know, to have an administration that is committed to expanding entrepreneurship, you know, in the black community and supporting it through training opportunities, you know, and, you know, funding. There are many countries that do support entrepreneurship, you know, and as venture capital, like the government actually invests in the business. They don't have to pay a loan back, because as an entrepreneur, you need to have venture capital that you're going to pay it back dividends. You know, you're going to pay it back. You're giving it like 20% ownership into your company, but you don't have to worry about making a payment until you make an offer to buy them out. And then you have to agree on, you know, the value of the shares and, you know, but there's, you know, private equity are things that our community overall needs to be more exposed to. Even in the minority business groups, they always talk about loans all the time, but I have asked several and they never allow me to come in, that I want to talk about the advantages of private equity. No. and there's so many opportunities for us there. But it's going to have to be introduced to us. And it's going to have, you know, and I think a lot of things, especially politically, that the black community has to increase its confidence and become more comfortable with its value. We have to know that what we offer and to a political candidate and how awesome we are as a community. We built this country. We built the country.
Yes, we did.
Yeah.
We built this country.
Yeah.
Where very few, you know, people can say that, you know, that their descendants, you know, we go back. We go back all the way. We're not immigrants. Some people get confused. I think they think, like, you know, Black Americans are immigrants or something. You know what I'm saying? No, we're... This is it. Our people were stolen for most of us. Mm-hmm. My whole Black experience is different than if I came here from, you know, Nigeria at 10 years old. I would have come with much more confidence than coming from a line of people who, you know, my skin is this color because of rape. Not because of love and a loving relationship. No, my family was raped during slavery. And we're not, like, you know, we're just letting all that go. We're not talking about how much we've been invested in. We're not talking about the sacrifices of all these generations, you know, when we allow them to throw out, like, you know, things, reproductive rights, when we're not even acknowledging the fact that we have Black women who their uteruses were taken from just because they were poor and lived in the South. Black men killed just because they Black. Black woman still just happening. This week shot in the face.
Still happening.
Any other people that this stuff has happened to and continue to happen to, that will have some sort of crisis center set up.
Yes.
Right? Where it's like... Hey. You know, we've been so programmed that we're not supposed to expect anything. Don't say that. She has to represent all people. You know what I'm saying? But he doesn't. I'm not going to ask anything from a white man that I'm not going to also ask from a Black woman. Just not. And we need to get clear about that. And don't ask a white man for more than you would ask a Black person for. The white guy's white. He got the majority as a challenge. And we still want him to acknowledge us. And you got a Black person and they're Black and we're saying, you want to convince me that we shouldn't ask about what we want, but only ask the white guy? That is socialization. That is a weakness that has been given to us. And we have to get over that. I don't care how high you go, you hire a Black person. You help a Black person up. You don't have to ignore all Black people just because you're Black and you got an important job and you think if you do that, then they won't, you know, you don't have any power then. So what is diversity, equity, and inclusion if we don't promote it ourselves?
Exactly.
What is it? Like, and why are we insulted by that term DEI hire? Why is that insulting?
Well, they try and make it insulting.
No, we let it be.
But we let it happen, yes.
That's right.
We let it happen.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. She's a DEI, you know, hire. No, and then, so you're trying to tell me that's not what we want? And I'm supposed to be upset about that? I just don't get that. So I looked up what is diversity and inclusion.
Right.
Create a workplace culture where all employees feel welcome to contribute and participate regardless of their age, race, gender, or preference. See, what Black folk do, when they do diversity, equity, and inclusion, they feel that they need to assimilate. The point is, I can't have no investment portfolio and all it has is the same thing in it. Even if it's in the same asset class, I don't want all the one stock. If I'm doing all stocks, you're doing all people, You know what? Sometimes that one you thought wasn't going to do anything really comes through, but only because I'm diversified. Mm-hmm. Why in the world do we think that we don't have anything to offer? So if you call me a DEI hire and I'm selling all of these investments over here, that there is something wrong with me and the company making all that money off me? Are you crazy? You can call me DEI all you want. You call me DEIIED, whatever. You making more money off me than I'm making. And that's what they were doing until I went independent. And then that's why they said, don't go. And I was the first Black woman and second Black. The Black person before me was a Hall of Fame football player. And he never had to sell and stay up and make cold calls and stuff. So let's just say I was the first regular Black person that the firm hired, and I showed out for everybody behind me. They won't even nobody. They ain't even hire nobody Black after that. They were just so heartbroken. They were heartbroken. She's gone. Look at her. Now she's on TV. Lord, that guy was scared they were going to take his job. That's diversity, equity, and inclusion. And when they would talk about me at UVA and they would say, you should be happy to be here. And I would go, I am happy to be here. But you talking about affirmative action may have gotten me in, but it didn't get me to this degree. And I'm the only one in this business school with a double major in accounting and finance. So you can sit down and shut up. That is how we should feel. When they talk about us with diversity, equity, and inclusion, it don't make you excellent.
Right. That's what Rob Lowe said that today on television. They were talking about he had hired his son.
Yes.
And he said, well, yeah, all I can do is show him the door. If he does not perform,
it's
on him.
That's right. I have fired family members. You know what I'm saying? Look, that's the inclusion. Look, we trying to be included, like, and that's why I never, my daughter has just started working with me, but she knows it's her thing is I want her to do it only if she really wants to do it. You know what I'm saying? I don't want anybody to make money and force nobody. I ain't never forcing nobody to make money, but I know not near one of her friends could make more money than she would make working with me. None of them coming out of college, none of them.
That's right.
10 years. 10 years out of college. All she got to do is follow. Follow what I do. 20 years. So all they got to do, you know what I'm saying? All we got to do, but you can't force it. Like Rob said, like, you know, they got to want it. You got to want it. But that is why we've got to pave the way. That's why we got to pave the way. That's why. You know, that is why I believe we need to have more businesses in our community.
Yeah.
You can't pass that on. When you're working somewhere else, you know what I'm saying? You might, but LeBron knows it too. He can't pass the NBA on. He's just trying to do the best that he can. But soon he's going to have to stop. Like, you know what I'm saying? But when you have your own business, like you said, there was one, somebody's saying today about this NBA player or NFL player that was trying to get them to pay an LLC, pay him in an LLC. Did I hear about a quarterback, this rookie? And he was like trying to be creative about his contract. Mm-hmm. And I was like, that's kind of ignorant on his part because he didn't understand you're an employee.
Right.
You're an employee of the NFL. You don't own, so you know what I'm saying? The NFL wish that they could give you a 1099. Do you know how different those guys' life would be? There'd be no NFL pension. There'd be no insurance. Like, you know what I'm saying? There'd be no liability for their concussion. None of the NFL's whole life would be different if they could let the players get a 1099. And that boy, somebody told him that this would be good from a tax perspective, but it would kill him from a physical perspective. Are you crazy? The only thing OJ was living off of was his pension. They couldn't sue him. They couldn't take it. If OJ just had a business and no NFL pension, OJ would have been broke.
Broke.
That's what makes him mad because OJ was all right. to the last day, last breath, because of being a superstar with the NFL. You are an employee. You use that. You start your LLC, your whatever, after you leave there. Or you can do it while you're there. You can do it. Like, but you can't get their paycheck. You work for them. You can't get that paid to a company. But somebody, he says he doesn't have an agent, I think, but he does. Somebody told him that, you know, try this, try that, or something he saw on TikTok. Isn't that sad? They're going to do that stuff, and the NFL is going to say, look, y'all going to have a lawyer. You know what I mean? Because they're going to get sick of that stuff. It's just, you know, oh. That's like the lawyer is not the enemy. The lawyer is just a person that is designed to help you. If they're not helping you, you get another one. But you help use them to their advantage and get a financial advisor. Because it could have been a lawyer that told him that ludicrousness. But if you had a financial advisor, I would have told you the truth. That's why they said no. So don't bring it up again and stop talking to the media about it, because it makes you look stupid. Nobody there. So we, But yeah, DEI, don't take it as an insult. We're fighting for that. If we're fighting for DEI, diversity, equity, and inclusion, we want them in. If we want it, then we cannot complain about it when someone says something about it. Yes, you're right. Look at this. Look at the greatness of it. We wouldn't have this opportunity. We would not have our first female presidential candidate if we didn't have DEI programs. If that's what she, if that is what she is, a what came from, then Lord, that's an argument for why it has to continue. If this person, this person, this person, this, all that came from DEI, that's not an insult. That's, wow, the world would be jacked up, wouldn't it? Look at all the good that person has done. Right?
Right.
Amen. Well, we're going to continue because we, you know, we have a while. So we're going to continue to keep an eye on this stuff. And I appreciate y'all, you know, like, let me know if we have any questions, you know, let me know if y'all think y'all agree with me with this, that we should put together a letter, send it to both parties about Black economic policy and what
we... Yeah, that would be interesting.
Right?
Yeah.
We should do it every time, shouldn't we? We should do this thing. No?
Everything. Send them an invitation to come to the meeting on Friday.
I think we will. Don't be trying to be funny.
I'm serious.
Don't be funny. You know when I used
to... Right, Jenny?
Well, y'all don't know, but when I was doing the Joe Madison show, I said, Joe, I think we need to have somebody on each side of this issue to go over. So it was an economic issue. And I was like, you know, oh, I wanted to talk about the economic policy of the two candidates or something. And the Democrats wouldn't show up. And Joe was like, so you're just going to let the Republican come on? I said, the Democrat wouldn't come. And so the person shared, like, you know, exactly what their policy was and this and that. And a lot of times that does happen. And we are so, like I was saying about our numbers, like some of the thoughts that we have are so off cue because we've been historically so committed to that party, when what we need to do is get more connected to policy. Mm-hmm. And if you're in the right party, you'll find out you are. But we do. I just didn't understand. I did not understand, you know, but in order to know policy, it's like, you know, when they tell you about this is how you pick a good man and you got this, 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 you know? Well, we got to do that with our politics. This is what I want my politician to, you know, focus on. This, 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 this. Like, what's important to you? You deserve it. You're worthy. I never knew I was worthy of anything. And I made selections accordingly. Now we got to change. So I can understand that. But you might have yours personally right, but you don't have your, you know, public policy right. But yeah, you deserve it. We deserve it. And I'm nonpartisan. So I'm not picking a side. The only side I'm on is yours. I'm on our side. I'm on God's side. That's it. Y'all can pick parties. Yo. Take care. Love y'all.
Love you. Love you.
Bye bye now.
Love you much.
Bye
bye. Bye
bye.
Bye
bye.
Yeah, solid rock. Thank you, Rita. Love you.
Night. Bye. All right, love you too. All right, good night.
Thank you, Queen Howard. Say it loud. I go to the rock. I go to the rock. When I need shelter, I go to the rock.